So you've been enjoying meeting the fan?
I certainly have. I've been having a lovely time.
Have you done these kind of events before?
I've done a few, but I've never done one on my home turf, which is England. So the fact that it's a little bit nippy, I know a lot of the Americans here, as you just said so yourself, were sort of intending to be sipping on Pimm's and sipping on gin and juice. But I'm just kind of liking the refreshing air and the fact that there's a lovely football field in front of us. So, and the people have been so nice. And it's just so lovely for me to know that all the work that I've been doing in America has been getting over here, and it makes me feel good. It's very nostalgic for me to be back here.
So you had quite a bit of experience meeting fans. Have you had any particularly memorable fan encounters over the years?
Well, the thing that I always find really touching is when you have really loyal fans. They tend to bring you things and they leave. They'll bring you presents, or I've got a couple of fans. With all the animation work that I've been doing lately, like the Clone Wars and Tarzan and Jane, this Anomaly project that I've got coming out, I had one fan who got a headshot of me, and then he literally put every single animated character that I'd ever done, from Morgan Le Fay to Carol Ferris to Jane from Tarzan and Jane to Luminara. I mean, the list just went on and on. And so, for example, for fans that can't afford to get a picture of you as well as an animated character, that was a great thing for him to give to me, because then I just ended up putting it on my table.
That's a wonderful gift. Now, I mean, talking about your live action work, first of all, I mean, what have fans been asking you most about when it comes to that? What's the most common question you get?
A Law and Order, a lot. Villainous Nicole Wallace. She's sort of a character that people tend to love to hate on television. But a lot of women like her because she's very smart. And she's able to sort of give Vincent Gorin, Detective Gorin, a run for his money. A lot of Wonder Years fans, obviously. People are really wanting to know when they can get the DVDs, and it's now out on Netflix, so you can get all the 115 because they've cleared the music publishing. So that's pretty nostalgic to audiences because they sort of identify with each character. People love the Star Trek episode that I did, the True Q, and a lot of Trekkies here. Clone Wars, they love. And Wayne's World 2 and Greedy, actually, which is a film that I did. I don't know, there's a lot of stuff. I've been really lucky. I've been able to manage to do like a quite diverse role. So I'm glad that people are sort of starting to connect the dots.
It's been an incredibly diverse career, and you've worked with some amazing people. Obviously, one of the biggest people you've worked with, metaphorically and literally, is Mr. Arnold Schwarzenegger. Can you talk a little bit about what it was like to work with him on Conan?
Yeah, it's just so ironic to me that he ended up being the governor of California. And, you know, I always knew that he was going to do very well politically. And obviously he was with Maria Shriver at the time, so he was a sort of fully fledged Republican. Nobody really wanted to get in a political debate with him because nobody was going to win. But he's a wonderful man. I mean, he was very into everybody's physical well-being. He'd get us up every morning at 6 a.m., wake us all up, knock on the door, Olivia, it's time to get up. I'm going to take you down to the gym. I don't care if you're sleeping in, not today. Grace, time to get up. We'd get your ass up, man. Let's go work out and pump some iron. And he'd just walk us all to the gym. Were you laughing at? Are you laughing? He's laughing at me. I can't believe it. I'm being serious. So, you know, from that aspect, he kept us all really fit, kept us all really happy, kept us laughing, which is really important when you're doing a film for 6 months down on location. He was great.
A long shoot, as you mentioned there. I mean, what was your, favorite? I mean, obviously you've got Arnold getting you up at 6 o'clock in the morning, but actually when you were filming, do you have any particular memorable experiences from that? Anything that always makes you smile when you look back?
Yeah, Richard Fleischer, who's unfortunately not with us anymore. He was just an absolutely brilliant director to work with. So gentle. So he would just sort of take you through each scene. He had a real, a wonderful, way with actors, and I was sort of 13 or 14 at the time, so I was very young. I didn't really have a lot of technique. I used just the natural my natural instinct. And there were some aspects with stunts and things like that where I'd think, oh my God, there's horses being, you know, sort of dragged to the floor. Are they all right? And he's like, no, it's Libby, it's just make believe, it's all right. And they're going to be fine. They're trained this way. And then Jack Cardiff, who was our DP, who shot the African Queen with like Humphrey Bogart and Katharine Hepburn. So I was really working with some very, some legends really. And I think it's only later on where I realized how lucky I am and what an honor it was to really be in that position. So I just sort of took as much in as I could. And Vic Armstrong is here. He's our stunt guy from Conan, and he's just given me his book, so I'm reading that. And he's a bit of a legend too. I mean, with Indiana Jones and all the films he's done with Spielberg.
He's done some fantastic work.
He's such an amazing guy. I don't think people really realize that he actually invented stunts. Had he not been around, I don't think that we'd be able to have the magnitude of amazing stunts that we do in really big Hollywood movies, because he just always has a finite way, a solution to get exactly what you want in the scene and to make it work and to make it real, where you actually think it's happening live, you know, real time.
Without him, Indiana Jones may not have punched Nazis.
I certainly don't think so. I mean, you know, I think Harrison Ford, I think the thing about Vic is he always taught me, he said, you know, you don't have to hurt yourself when you fall. If you keep yourself limber, you just fall into it. He said, just keep yourself like a rubber band and stay really fluid and loose, and that way you'll never break a bone. And that stuck with me. I never have.
I'm very glad to hear that you haven't broken anything over the years. But you have been very busy, and especially, I mean, bringing it back to our small screens. The Wonder Years, I mean, what do you think it is about? Because, like you say, there's been a desperate fan cry for the release of the series. It's now finally with us. Why do you think it's endured so much? What do you think it was about that show that people love so much?
Well, I think for Americans, as well as the rest of the world, America's been, you know, such an incredibly important country in just universally to all of us. And I think historically what went on with Vietnam and how that sort of broke the country in half, the music that was going on from sort of 68 to sort of 74, the history, the politics, all of it, I think it's just a nostalgic piece, and it's fallen under the category of just great television. The characters were all very identifiable, from the mother to Fred's character to Winnie. All of the topical things that they decided to bring up in the storylines and integrate. And I think the most important thing that I think sticks in people's minds is that there's a lesson at the end of each show that's sort of bittersweet. Even though it's written as a comedy, there's also some melancholic elements to it, such as life. So I think that people leave sort of with a fuzzy, warm feeling at the end of every show. And I think that's one of the reasons it's also quite timeless, because I think young people, like my son, for example, watches it now, and he completely relates to it. Doesn't matter that it was set in the 60s. I think it was the approach, the filmic approach, and the formulaic way that they approached each show. It just worked. It was just a chemistry between the actors, the creator, the directors that they hired, and the stories were always very well written.
Wonderfully well written show, and like you say, I think you know, had a lot of messages behind it. I mean, fans will have their own favorite episodes or favorite storylines. Is there one looking back that you're particularly proud of, or you think was particularly special?
Yeah. Well, I loved the one with the pimple, when Fred just got a pimple that kept getting larger and larger and larger, and he didn't quite know whether to squeeze it, or I know that sounds sort of gross. There were some of them that just were really funny and odd and quirky. I also like one that I had with Jack Arnold, who played my dad, called Angel, where he gives me his dog tag at the end of the show. It's my birthday, and you know, obviously he's from the baby boomer age, and he gives me this dog tag. You know, Karen's always sort of doing her own thing. She's a bit of a rebel. But I think the fact that they go head to head so much on the show, she was really the one kid that would stand up to him rather than the other two boys, because she was sort of the most pig-headed and like him. So like daughter, like father. I liked that particular episode, and the one where I skipped school and Fred had to go to school and get things out of my locker, and we had these scenes up at a place called The Hill where I'd hang out with all my hippie friends. I also loved the wedding episode with David Schwimmer from Friends, where we were all in a circle, because I got really dizzy shooting that scene because it was him and I in the epicenter of the circle, and then Norma and Jack and Kevin and Wayne, and then like all these hippies around us. So it was like one circle would move one way counterclockwise, the other one, and I just sort of think, I can't believe I do this for a living. This is like a real experience we're having. So that was a nice one, and then they moved to Alaska in that episode. There's a lot of them that I like, but those are my three favorite ones.
Some fantastic episodes.
The second one, which was Kevin going to work with Jack. Yeah, that was a brilliant one. That's when Neil and Carol Marlins were still involved in the show. And it was just really... They weren't really sticking to any specific rules or boundaries. They just sort of did what they want. And so we had fun. Like, I got to play Jack's secretary. And it was all kind of a dream that Kevin was having. But ultimately, when you saw the show, you thought that he really was going to work with Jack. And it's something that I think a little boy really wants to do with his dad at that particular age. So, again, it's sentimental.
Fans will kill me if I don't ask. You've been involved with two of the biggest franchises in science fiction. One of the few people who's been involved with both, Star Wars, Clone Wars, and, of course, your episode of Star Trek you mentioned earlier. Can you talk a little bit about what it was like to be involved with both of those?
Well, it's really interesting. I was just talking to somebody who wanted both a Star Trek and a Clone Wars picture. And I grew up with Star Wars. I grew up with Star Trek, my brother and I, and philosophically, I think just what's behind, you know, maybe may the force be with you, and the wisdom behind those Star Wars movies, and the science fiction elements that are applicable to both shows, they were infiltrated into my psyche at a very young age. So I suppose if one's a believer of law of attraction, which I very much am, I think that you do. I think that you manifest things, and for whatever reason, I suppose I manifested playing a Q with special powers. It wasn't like it was an easy job to get. I went in and I met 20 of these writers, and they said, "Have you done a lot of theater?" And I said, "Well, I've done enough to know that I know how to memorize lines really well." And they said that that's a really important component to the show. They don't hire any actors who haven't done theater and stage, because they will literally throw a monologue at you 2 minutes before you've got to do it, with very long words, some of which I'd never heard of. Science words, you know. And I failed miserably at science. So, but I do have a photographic memory. So they hired me on the premise of that. And I think they were looking for a quality, you know, of just this a young woman who is sort of bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, but an orphan, but really wanted to learn. And she was the apprentice of the ship. And she was there to learn. And she had these special powers. And she could have gone either way, to the light or the darkness. And though she was sort of reeled in by John Delancey's role, I think ultimately Captain Picard's character takes me more toward the light, and he says, "Amanda, your power really lies within the light and saving this planet." And so that was quite an emotional scene for me. And then with Luminara, I get to play a Jedi. I don't know how that came into my life, but it did. They were going to do two shows, and then they just had me back because she ended up being a popular character. So, again, I'm completely honored and lucky, and you know, it's strange. The science fiction thing, I've just done a project called Anomaly, which is going to Comic-Con this summer, where I play the captain of the ship. So I finally get to play the captain of a ship. So I think that's going to do really well. And I love science fiction, so I'm just happy to be getting those sort of jobs.
We're very excited to hear about that Comic-Con project. Can you tell us any more? I mean, obviously you're going to be captain. Can you tell us anything else about the show?
It's a science fiction future animated film, which is all about a lost planet, finding a lost planet called Anomaly. And I decide my characters... Samantha decides to call it Anomaly, and then they get on this planet and all kinds of things, which I really can't get into because it'll be a surprise, happen to her and her crew. And she falls in love. There's a little bit of the formula of Princess Leia and Han Solo in there, where they kind of like go head to head, and she's quite a toughie because she's got a sort of like tell everybody what to do, but beneath it she's got a heart of gold, and ultimately she ends up being with sort of the Han Solo character in it.
Han Solo, I think I'm already slightly in love. It's been absolutely amazing talking to you today. I'm conscious we've got to let you get back to fans here, but for any fans that couldn't join us today, do you have any message for them before you leave us?
I'm just always very honoured and moved to meet all the fans that are here, not only for me, but just to support, you know, what it is that we do, because at the end of the day, it's you guys that inspire us to keep wanting to do what we do, other than obviously our own internal inspiration. But you guys are the ones that make the difference in terms of really, it's very meaningful, it's very touching, and I love getting out there and meeting the fans. I think it's one of the most important things, because you realize how much what it is that you do really touches people. And though being an actor on many, many, many levels, you know, people say, oh, it's trite, you're just an actor, but if you can accomplish a certain kind of work that's meaningful to people, I think that you are making a contribution, and I think that's what we're all here to do. So
thank you very much for doing that and for talking to us. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you.